Hello friends, welcome to EPG Pathshala Linguistics. I am Ajay Sarvaiya, Assistant Professor in the Department of Linguistics, the Maharaja Sayajirao University of Baroda. Today we will deal with the module Cognitive Semantics Metaphor from the paper Language Studies. The module consists of 5 sections. The first section deals with introduction. The second section deals with classical theory. The third section deals with cognitive theory. The fourth section deals with image schemas. And the fifth section provides summary. 1. Introduction. Metaphor in cognitive semantics is not just a poetic device or just a figure of speech. It is treated as a conceptual structure. It is a fundamental property of the everyday use of language. Metaphors involve not only ways of talking about phenomena, but also ways of thinking about them. Also, vast domains of our experience, understanding, reasoning, and practice are metaphorically structured. Metaphors allow us to understand one domain of experience in terms of another. One conceptual domain, usually concrete, physical, and experiential, is mapped onto another conceptual domain, usually abstract and mental, through metaphors. Meaning in cognitive semantics is conceptualized in terms of conventionalized cognitive structures, which emerge from our experience of growing up and acting in the world. A number of cognitive conceptual structures and processes are identified in the cognitive semantics literature. Metaphor is one of them. Metaphor is an essential element in our categorization of the world and our thinking processes. 2. Classical theory. The classical position conceptualizes metaphor as a form of figurative language use, a poetic device, a trope, which involves transference of properties from one domain to another. The concept that is described is called the target domain, while the concept to which it is compared is called the source domain. The classical position associated with Aristotle regards metaphor as a kind of ornamental addition, a rhetorical device used to achieve certain effects. In Greece, metaphor was studied within the discipline known as rhetoric. Due to the central importance of metaphor, it was regarded as the master trope by rhetoricians. This position describes metaphor as something exterior to normal or literal language, and which requires special forms of interpretation from listeners. Searle describes the process with an interesting example. If a listener comes across an utterance, "Sam is a pig," he knows that it cannot be literally true. Literally, it is radically defective. Such defectiveness is considered a feature of all the metaphorical expressions. Such defects provide clue to the hearer that the utterance is obviously false. It is semantically nonsense. It violates the rules of speech acts or violates the conversational principles of communication. According to Searle, this suggests a strategy that underlies the first step, where, if taken literally, the utterance is defective. Therefore, look for an utterance meaning that differs from the sentence meaning. There is another traditional approach to metaphor, known as the Romantic view, associated with 18th and 19th century Romantic views of the imagination. This approach regards metaphor as an integral part of language and thought, as a way of experiencing the world. Metaphor is considered to play a role in conceptualizing and reasoning, and therefore, all language is considered metaphorical. This approach does not distinguish between literal and figurative language. 3. cognitive theory. The publication of Lakoff and Johnson's Metaphors We Live By changed the whole way of understanding and thinking about metaphors and its relation to language, thought, and action. Metaphor is not a mere trope, but a conceptual structure through which we make sense of the reality. In cognitive semantics, metaphor is assigned the central role in thought and language. The cognitive approach is seen as an extension of the romantic view. However, the romantic position is strong as it considers that all language and all thought are metaphorical. The cognitive position, on the other hand, accepts metaphorical as well as literal aspects of thought and language. Metaphors play a significant role in allowing us to understand one domain of experience, generally abstract, in terms of another, generally concrete. When we talk about life in terms of journeys, arguments in terms of war, love in terms of journeys, theories in terms of buildings, ideas in terms of food, we are using conceptual metaphors. The conceptual metaphors are formally mentioned in the following manner. Conceptual domain A is conceptual domain B, or target domain is source domain. Lakoff lists the following traditional assumptions that he describes as false. All everyday conventional language is literal and none is metaphorical. All subject matter can be comprehended literally without metaphor. Only literal language can be contingently true or false. All definitions given in the lexicon of a language are literal, not metaphorical. The concepts used in the grammar of a language are all literal. None are metaphorical. These assumptions associated with the notions of language, meaning, and grammar are rejected in cognitive semantics on the basis of empirical data. Lakoff and Johnson have identified a large number of common metaphors on the basis of ample empirical data. For example, they describe one group as spatial metaphors associated with an up-down orientation. Let us see a few selected examples. 1. Happy is up, sad is down. I am feeling up, my spirits rose. You are in high spirits, I am feeling down. I am depressed, he is really low these days. My spirits sank. 2. Conscious is up, unconscious is down. Wake up, he fell asleep. He dropped off to sleep. He is under hypnosis. He sank into a coma. 3. Health and life are up. Sickness and death are down. He is at the peak of health. He is in top shape. He fell ill. He is sinking fast. He came down with the flu. His health is declining. 4. Having control or force is up. Being subject to control or force is down. I have control over her. He is at the height of his powers. He is in a superior position. He ranks above me in strength. He is under my control. He fell from power. He is my social inferior. 5. High status is up, low status is down. He has a lofty position. She will rise to the top. He is at the peak of his career. He is climbing the ladder. He has little upward mobility. He is at the bottom of the social hierarchy. She fell in status. 6. Good is up, bad is down. Things are looking up. We hit a peak last year, but it's been downhill ever since. Things are at an all-time low. He does high-quality work. 7. Virtue is up, depravity is down. He is high-minded. She has high standards. She is an upstanding citizen. That was a low trick. Don't be underhanded. I wouldn't stoop to that. That was a low-down thing to do. The cognitive theory of metaphors explains that these metaphors are based on our bodily experiences of lying down and getting up, and their connections with consciousness, health, power, etc. Metaphor could be a device, a trope, but in the cases cited earlier, metaphors function as conceptual structures through which we conceptualize happiness, health, power, etc. Such conceptual structures permeate ordinary language as they are grounded in our experience. In the literature of cognitive semantics, quite a few features of metaphor are discussed. We will, however, discuss two features, which are systematicity and asymmetry. Language users are generally unaware about the use of metaphors. For example, sentences like, she is in trouble, he belongs to a lower class, she has achieved a high position in her job, involve conventional conceptual metaphors, but language users may not recognize them. The naming of many new concepts involve metaphorical extensions. For example, computer terms such as web, bug, and virus. Similarly, the transference of attributes from animal to human functions in the same fashion. For example, pig, lion, fox, donkey, etc. The feature systematicity refers to a systematic correspondence or mapping between the source domain and the target domain. Both these domains relate to each other on more than one attribute in such a way that they have some internal logic. Lakoff and Turner discovered a systematic correspondence or mapping between the two domains of experience. 8. Life is a journey. The person leading a life is a traveler. His purposes are destinations. The means for achieving purposes are paths. Difficulties in life are impediments to travel. Progress is the distance traveled. Language users employ such a mapping every day in ordinary speech when they use expressions like, he knows where he is going in life. He is at a crossroads in his life. He got a head start in life. I can't ever seem to get to where I want to be in life. He followed an unconventional course during his life. He works his way around many obstacles. His life had been a rather strange journey. The feature asymmetry refers to metaphors being directional. The correspondence or mapping between the source domain and target domain is not symmetrical. There is generally transference of features from the source to the target. For example, in the utterance, Sam is a pig, Sam is compared with pig. However, one would not find an utterance where a pig is compared with Sam. Similarly, a face is compared with the moon, where the face is the target domain and the moon is the source domain. The symmetrical reversal in terms of the moon being the target domain and the face being the source domain is hard to find. Lakoff and Johnson describe the metaphor time is money, where the abstract and mysterious domain of time is described in terms of the concrete domain of money. However, money is generally not described in terms of time. 9. Time is money. You are wasting my time. Can you give me a few minutes? How do you spend your time? We are running out of time. Is that worth your while? It is generally found that a typical metaphor consists of a more concrete source to portray a more abstract target. For example, the abstract domain of the beauty of a face is described in terms of the concrete moon. Similarly, in life is a journey metaphor, the ordinary experience of physically moving about the earth is employed to portray the mysterious process of birth and death, also the process of aging, love, career, etc. The source and target could be equally concrete or abstract. 4. Image schemas. Image schemas are primitive level of cognitive conceptual structures which provide a link between bodily experience and cognitive domains such as language. Image schemas emerge from our sensory and perceptual experience as we interact with and move about in the world. They are dynamic structures by which we organize our experience. They constantly operate in our perception and bodily movement. Image schemas are metaphorically projected from concrete to abstract domains of understanding. Because of our physical experience of being and acting in the world, of perceiving the environment, moving our bodies, exerting and experiencing force, etc., we form basic conceptual structures which we then use to organize thought across a range of more abstract domains. For example, the containment schema emerges from our experience of being physically located within enclosed locations like rooms, buildings, etc. Our experience of putting objects into containers and also from experiencing human body as a container. Such experience constructs an abstract schema of physical containment of an entity within an enclosed location. Lakoff argues that many areas of experience are metaphorically structured by means of a small number of image schemas. A small set of image schemas give rise to a significant number of metaphors. A few of the image schemas are described below. A. Containment. The image schema consists of a container with its inside and outside as described above. The image schema is extended metaphorically to a large number of non-spatial domains. Linguistic expressions are conceptualized as containers. For example, put ideas into words, the content of an essay, empty words, as are emotional states. For example, be in love, fall out of love, be in trouble, be in depression. B. Proximity and distance. The schema, which is based on spatial relations, is extended to non-spatial domains. Thus, degree of emotional attachment or intimacy is conceptualized in terms of proximity and distance. For example, a close friend, a close advisor, a distant relative. C. Linkage and separation. Like the proximity-distance schema, the schema of linkage and separation are spatial notions that can be applied to abstractions. For example, make contact with people, keep in touch, break social and family ties or relations. D. Front-back orientation. This schema is applied to the human body, as the front of a human body is the side where major sensory organs like the eyes are located. The front is also the side or direction in which a human being moves. Time is conceptualized in terms of the front-back schema. The future is conceptualized as located in front. For example, look forward to the future. Whereas the past is located at the back. For example, look back on the past. E. The part-whole relationship. The whole consists of parts that are arranged in a particular order. The whole gets destroyed if the parts are separated or rearranged. This schema is metaphorically extended to the abstract notions of interpersonal relations. A married couple is conceptualized as a whole. The divorce is expressed as split up or break up. Later, they may come together again. F. Up-down orientation. We have examined quite a few examples in section 3. These image schemas are grounded in the embodied experience and they are metaphorically extended to abstract notions, states, and events. 5. Summary. Lakoff and Johnson list 4 false assumptions regarding metaphor. The first, metaphor is a matter of words, not concepts. The second, metaphor is based on similarity. The third, all concepts are literal and none can be metaphorical. The fourth, rational thought is not shaped by the nature of our brains and bodies. However, research on metaphor has conclusively established that all 4 assumptions are false. First, the locus of metaphor is in concepts, not words. Second, metaphor is, in general, not based on similarity. Instead, it is typically based on cross-domain correlations in our experience, which give rise to the perceived similarities between 2 domains within the metaphor. Third, the most abstract concepts such as time, events, causation, morality, mind, etc. are understood and explained through various metaphors. In fact, it is hard to find a literal manner of speaking about these concepts. Fourth, conceptual metaphors are not arbitrary or historically contingent. Rather, they are formed by the common nature of our brains and bodies and the shared ways that we all function in the everyday world. Our rational thoughts as well as actions are also affected by conceptual metaphors. This is where we end the module. I look forward to meeting you in future.